This is Software Engineering Radio, the podcast for professional developers on the web at se-radio.net. SE Radio is brought to you by the IEEE Computer Society and by IEEE Software Magazine, online at computer.org/software.
Keeping your teams on top of the latest tech developments is a monumental challenge. Helping them get answers to urgent problems they face daily is even harder. That's why 66% of all Fortune 100 companies count on O'Reilly Online Learning. At O'Reilly, your teams will get live courses, tons of resources, interactive scenarios and sandboxes, and fast answers to their pressing questions. See what O'Reilly Online Learning can do for your teams. Visit O'Reilly.com for a demo.
Hello, everyone. This is Felina for Software Engineering Radio. Today with me on the show is Evan Weaver. Evan is a former director of infrastructure at Twitter, where he was the 15th employee. He holds a master's degree in computer science and has previously worked at CNET and SAP. Currently, he is the co-founder, CTO, and co-inventor of Fauna. Welcome to the show, Evan.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So today we are going to talk about your product, Fauna. And according to your website, Fauna is a flexible, developer-friendly, transactional database delivered to you as a secure web-native API. So that's a lot to cover, and I want to talk about all those separate attributes. But let's first talk about the basics. What problem does Fauna solve?
So Fauna solves a problem that we experienced at Twitter. So I joined Twitter, it was ancient history now, it's 2008. The height of the Web 2.0 era, in the midst of the early stages of cloud adoption. And I came from CNET. I built consumer websites with Ruby on Rails primarily and MySQL. And, you know, I went to Twitter because I wanted the product to survive. You know, I didn't have big dreams about building distributed systems or implementing databases or anything like that. But we found, you know, as the handful, like the half dozen engineers who were at the company at the time, there's nothing off the shelf that would let a team like ours scale a product, especially a global soft real-time product like Twitter, from small to large. And we had to invest in, you know, learning and studying and inventing new technology and new strategies and algorithms in distributed systems just to keep the product scaling. That didn't make a lot of sense to us. We felt like, you know, there's nothing intrinsic in information science that says you can't have something which is both flexible to build against in the small and scalable in the large. There were no systems off the shelf that could do it. In particular, there were no operational data systems that could do it. Operational data is the most conservative part of, you know, the industry in a lot of ways because it's the riskiest. It's your mission critical data. It's your user data. It's things that are irreplaceable. And we were dealing with systems like MySQL and its primary secondary statement-based replication. Looked at Postgres as well, looked at Mongo as well, looked at Cassandra and invested a lot in Cassandra in the early days of the NoSQL era. And just none of these systems could scale without these discontinuous, you know, architecture events along the way. So we ended up re-architecting things almost on an annual basis. That was very frustrating. I don't think anyone works on databases out of love for existing databases. They work on them because they're frustrated that things are not better than they are, and they see a path to eliminating that area of pain for future developers who have to work with data, and we're no different. So after spending 4 years at Twitter and scaling all the core business objects and writing a bunch of custom distributed systems, we founded Fauna and did a bunch of consulting for 4 years, exploring the data space, and then, you know, eventually realized that if we didn't solve this fundamental problem, it wasn't going to get solved. So we embarked on product development. That's Fauna and FaunaDB.
So to summarize, I think what you're saying is that the biggest problem that you found is that existing solutions were not flexible or they weren't scalable enough.
Right, exactly. Yeah, you had to make trade-offs at every step of the way. That means, too, it doesn't just mean like things are hard for companies that are succeeding. It means there are all kinds of companies and products and applications that just don't get built because the incidental cost of scalability and operations and management and administration and all this stuff is too high, you know, to justify the investment. So, you know, it's kind of similar to, you know, in the 90s, if you wanted to have a website, you had to rack a bunch of hardware and configure, you know, a bunch of custom databases, and like fussing around with Apache was a big deal. We don't have to do any of that stuff anymore. And we forget, you know, how much of a drag that was on productivity in the industry, and even having like a basic HTML page like yahoo.com out the door was tough. So, you know, there are few entrants in the early market of the web. But now we're still in the same place, even with managed cloud, where, you know, you have to deal with provisioning and the sort of the physicality of your data in order to build an application. And especially as the world goes more global and goes more remote, none of that really makes sense. It's all extraneous cost.
Yeah, that makes sense. So can you describe a typical use case of Fauna? You already described, of course, the scalability part of it. And what type of situation for developers would it make sense to consider Fauna as an alternative to whatever database you're currently using?
So Fauna is a serverless operational data API. So it serves the same role as the traditional operational database, whether that's a NoSQL database like Mongo or an RDBMS like MySQL or Postgres. And what Fauna does is provide you the basic building blocks of a soft real-time, you know, consumer or B2B facing service. It could be a CRM, it could be some other SaaS, it could be social media, it could be video gaming, anything where you need to transact across business data, user data, all the usual concerns in the OLTP or operational data sphere. And Fauna is designed to both offer serverless provisioning and serverless scalability, so you don't have to do any operations at all, and to fit well with the rest of the serverless stack or as augmentation to the managed cloud stack so that you can continue to build your products, build your applications without having to incur additional operational overhead or debt. You know, another way to look at it is it's sort of serverless overall is a return and a realization of the dream of utility computing. And we used to talk about that a lot in the 90s. And, you know, we tried to manage it by fussing around with Perl scripts and that kind of thing. And it didn't really work. Well, it's back. And it's back in a big way with different interfaces, especially the POSIX interfaces for containers and that kind of thing, and WebAssembly and other lighter ways to isolate compute. And we have CDNs, which offer asset hosting in a truly serverless and zero operations way. But we started this project kind of before serverless was real, but the vision has always been the same. You know, what if you could interact with your data with a ubiquitous, utility-priced global API, and you never had to think about where that data lived ever again?
So I think what you're saying is if you already have a solution that runs in the cloud, runs on Heroku or AWS, and you want to extend that with database functionality, then it really makes sense to look at Fauna because it's also serverless.
Yeah, if you're building with the rest of the serverless stack, and that could be Jamstack, it could be server-side compute with AWS Lambda, or you have an existing managed or even on-prem application where you don't want to make further investment in the operations of that system. Your typical Postgres installation, for example, gets to a point where people are afraid to migrate a column or add a table because there's no performance isolation. You know, it's risky. So where else do you put your data? Well, you don't really want to keep spinning up Postgreses that'll keep having these problems. The one you currently have is working perfectly fine, so you probably don't want to take the risk of migrating it to something brand new. Even a different edition of Postgres can be risky. But you can take something like Fauna and add it into that application stack, integrate it through web APIs and service APIs, and start to get the benefit of that utility computing, that serverless data for the augmented features.
This actually perfectly segues into the question I was going to ask next, because you also say that Fauna is a flexible database. And I think you just touched upon that, on addressing the pain of adding a column to a database that people might be worried to make changes. I guess that's where you are different, that this flexibility means that it is easier to make changes to your data model.
Yeah, Fauna is designed to minimize operational overhead and maximize developer productivity. That means we chose not to directly implement SQL. Fauna is a relational database. It offers transactions and indexes and views and foreign keys and all that good stuff from the relational model. But it doesn't, at least currently, expose a SQL interface. It exposes a document relational interface over GraphQL, which is a web standard you may be familiar with that's very popular, especially in the Jamstack space, and FQL, which is our own language, which is a functional relational language. It's essentially a Lisp, although we try not to talk about that too loud because a lot of people are scared of Lisp. But it gives you a more safe and semantically pure way of interacting with the data, which includes things like dealing with documents which also retain their history. So you're not, you know, discarding data just by updating records. You can go back and look at a particular point in time. It's type safe. It lets you compose queries. It lets you store stored procedures as functions that execute business logic globally in the database and compose it. And essentially gives you programmable access in a modern way to your data set.
Those things are all, by the way, things I want to ask you a little bit more about. So the stored procedures and the different types of interfaces. We will definitely zoom into that later in the episode. But firstly, let's talk about that flexibility a little bit more to give listeners an idea of what Fauna can mean. Can you give an example of a case in which this flexibility really helped solve a customer problem?
I'll give you two examples, and I'll give you one on sort of the feature set side. So we have a customer named ShiftX. They have a business process modeling tool. And one of the things they took advantage of Fauna with in their tool is they took advantage of the temporality to let their own users go back in time and see how their process models have changed. And that's the kind of thing that in a traditional database, whether it's NoSQL or SQL, you have to build as a secondary concern in your business model. And that gets very confusing, especially in a typical SaaS application. You end up trying to implement these partially application-facing, partially database-facing concerns like bitemporality, multi-tenancy, in application code. There's a lot of security features which are missing from the SQL interface in particular, and that all pollutes your application. It makes it hard to iterate, makes it hard to sort of maintain that kind of purity of approach to the business problem you're trying to solve. They were able to use the temporality feature directly to expose time travel and just move on to bigger and better things. On the operational side, in particular, the serverless nature of Fauna means that you never have to provision any specific level of scale. You can rely on the database to scale like an API, which is to say you don't think about it. Capacity is always there. You pay by usage. You don't pay by like scheduled time or some variation of that. And a use case I just saw the other day, someone's building an application that is used at conferences, and you know they're anticipating a return to in-person conferences. And you know, one of the challenges with conference attendance and especially connectivity is that like the Wi-Fi never works when you're actually in the room with 100 other people trying to get on the Wi-Fi. They're building a semi-offline application which will work while it has partial or zero connectivity, and then when connectivity is restored, it uploads the data to the cloud and you know makes it accessible to others. And that means basically, whenever these groups disperse, there's a huge spike of synchronization from people who suddenly have network access. And like, you don't want to provision for that spike all the time because you're wasting money running databases at 0% utilization while people have no connectivity all as a group. But at the same time, if you provision for a small amount of capacity, then you're going to have failed queries, timed out queries. The application isn't going to work in these synchronization points. So they're taking advantage of Fauna's operational flexibility to just eliminate that concern entirely from their application process. And instead of doing like exponential backoff and this and that and all the kind of things you'd have to usually do to work around this problem, they can just rely on Fauna to make capacity available as needed.
Great. So I think the two things you mentioned were that you get scalability for free. You don't have to think about it. If you have certain peaks in use, then that is covered automatically. And indeed, you don't have to buy lots of servers just to cover for these peaks that might happen very rarely. And also the other point you mentioned, that temporality, that sounds so interesting that you have time travel by default. Can you talk a little bit more how that works as a developer? Because like what I'm envisioning is something like select star from customers yesterday or something. How do you interface with a database that has temporality built in?
That is essentially how it works. One of the reasons we implemented FQL, Fauna Query Language, our own language, instead of SQL is that, you know, SQL is a business analysis language. It was designed for people sitting at workstations writing reports. You know, security was managed outside the language itself. Performance was managed outside the language itself. There are all these concerns which are now intrinsic to building in particular SaaS and consumer-facing web applications, which those kind of interfaces make no attempt to solve. And temporality is one of the things that we saw a lot of need for, both in backing direct user-facing application features like time travel, like select this document at a point in the past, see the changes between two points. It's related to the streaming capability, which I think we're going to talk about in a little bit. But also, you know, for things like change data capture for synchronization with second systems like analytics systems, it's very important in particular to be able to do cheap update queries to see if anything has changed rather than having to table scan all the time, because all the records are fundamentally unpartitioned by time, even though they have a time column added to them because it's at the application code. So the database has no aware. It's in the application layer, so the database has no awareness of it. And, you know, other things like the web native security model, which makes it possible to access the database safely over the public internet. Everything's secure by default, unlike the opposite, where you have to use firewalls and VPCs and so on to try to lock down administrative access to the database. Of the granularity that lets you authenticate users directly against the database. It's only essentially operators who can mess with one table at a time, all that kind of stuff. Like, what we've tried to do is basically retrace, in particular, the history of MySQL and its ability to be a general purpose transactional data platform for what was at the time the modern web, the LAMP stack, Web 2.0 and serverless operational context for the way that the stack has changed. And I think historically, you know, we get a new development stack about every 10 years. And that stack typically has only one database that really becomes the default database that's chosen for it. And I think part of this is, you know, points to some of the conservatism or the riskiness of making that choice. Like, people aren't choosing an operational database just for one project. They're choosing it for their company overall, and even oftentimes for their career. It's a huge investment to learn a new database, to learn to operate it, in particular for the pre-serverless databases, operate it safely, interact with the consistency model appropriately, and so on. So in the 90s, you know, we had MySQL with LAMP, and we had SQL Server with the Microsoft stack. So there was a bifurcation there because we had two totally different stacks, even though they shared some concepts. Then in the O's, we got Postgres with the ORM, kind of the ORM generation with Hibernate and Active Record. And then in the 10s, we got Mongo and the Mean stack. And we have a new stack now, the serverless stack, and it needs a database. So, you know, we're bringing back everything you would expect from the traditional relational model, but updated and revised and re-implemented for serverless operations and serverless development.
So diving into that a little bit more about the options there are to be, let's say, the next database for this era, who do you think Fauna's biggest competitors are and how are you different from them?
We see DynamoDB the most. And DynamoDB has done a good job in that utility computing aspect, giving you multi-tenant granular billing based on usage. Where it hasn't done a good job is maintaining the flexibility of the relational model and eliminating the physicality of the database from the application level concerns. Because Dynamo is an eventually consistent system. It was derived in, you know, funnily, you know, in one of these like weird quirks of history, it was derived from Cassandra, which itself was derived from the old DynamoDB, which was an internal Amazon project. But it came full circle as a NoSQL rich key value store that was designed for low latency and consistent performance, not for developer flexibility and productivity. Amazon has made a lot of retrofit updates to it, like adding optional transactions and optional indexes and that kind of thing, but they don't compose because the model is not fundamentally built around an architecture which is amenable to, compared to Fauna, transactionality all the time. And ubiquitously available, consistent indexes all the time, and rich relational queries that can express flexible business logic and that kind of thing. So on the pricing side, like, does it scale up and down dynamically? Yes, you know, in that sense, it is competitive. In the developer flexibility side, it's not. And we see that a lot. You know, and you can compare it to Mongo. I think Mongo offers more developer flexibility, but the Mongo Atlas cloud product is not serverless, and it's never going to be because the architecture isn't there. Various other vendors have approached like one aspect of this problem, but because of the legacy baggage and there's so much path dependence, especially in operational data, because it's so risky, there's just no path for them to really deliver the full picture without starting over from ground zero like we did.
Yeah, and of course, you set all those requirements from the beginning. So that's why it might be a little bit easier to actually hit that sweet spot.
Our story is a little atypical, I think, for Silicon Valley or for startups. We were a tech-first startup. We saw this technical problem at Twitter. We believed we could solve it. We watched as it, you know, continued to go unsolved in industry. And then we embarked on the journey to solve it. Once we had solved these core problems of basically global serverless transactional database management, we had to figure out how to take it to market. You compare to someone, you know, a company like Mongo, which found its product market fit very early, but then had to retrofit technology because they literally had nothing. They had like an mmapped file and a JavaScript process. Like there's no database there. There's just an interface. We went the other way. We built architecture. And then essentially we were too early to market and had to wait for the serverless market to catch up and be ready for what our original vision was. And then, you know, we had to make tweaks along the way, like adding the GraphQL interface and so on, and in particular, improving the comprehensiveness of the FQL standard library to meet the developer flexibility and productivity goals. But at the end of the day, you know, the serverless vision of ubiquitous utility computing has always been our vision.
Yeah, great. So one thing I want to zoom in a little bit more about, you say that you have transactionality all the time. What does that entail?
Transactionality is essentially data correctness at the highest level. And databases are more or less partitioned into consistent transactional databases or eventually consistent non-transactional databases. One of the issues, especially when we were starting out with Fauna, was that there's a general idea, especially pushed by the NoSQL vendors, that having data consistency and having scalability were fundamentally antagonistic to each other, and that you couldn't have a system which did both. If you needed to scale, then scalability is the most critical operational capability that you can have, because it doesn't matter if your data is correct if no one can get to it. Then you should give up consistency and correctness in favor of scale, and then try to add back in application code, whatever sort of band-aids over the, essentially the corrupt state of your operational data you needed to keep the application working. And we knew that that wasn't the case based on our experience building the distributed systems at Twitter. When we started Fauna, we wanted to make sure that we chose a replication and a transaction architecture, which would both give us low latency at global scale, and literally the lowest possible latency, which I can elaborate on in a minute, but also never give up the highest level of consistency, which is strict serializability, which basically means you can treat the entire database cluster, not just a single machine, but the entire cluster as if it was local to you, as if everything is happening in a serial physical order, one transaction at a time in that database. And that's a very easy model for developers to reason about compared to eventual consistency, which is essentially relativistic. Like different clients, different applications, different users accessing the database all see different views of the state of the world, and they cannot fundamentally be reconciled in real time.
Yeah, and it might also be cognitively harder for programmers to think indeed of all those different versions, whereas the transaction model might be closer to what people are used to.
Yeah, the transaction model is intuitive. It's just, you can essentially imagine that there's a giant lock around the entire database and only one user can access it at a time. And obviously that isn't the case in Fauna, and it can't be the case because although you could implement it, your throughput would be pretty poor. But yeah, we saw based on our experience at Twitter and in our consulting days at Fauna that not just your average developer, but even your best developers just could not reasonably reason about the consistency of their data in the context of their application code. It's just not possible. Like data consistency is the domain of formal proofs and very aggressive adversarial analysis of the systems to make sure that the implementation matches the proof and all that kind of stuff. And like, that's not how people build products. There's no formal proof for Twitter, TikTok, or what have you. Like, it doesn't make any sense. It's a waste of time. it would not even be possible given the complexity of the, you know, the service topologies that go into these products.
Yeah, so let's zoom into this topic a little bit more, because it looks like you do support replication. So is Fauna a distributed system?
We are a distributed system. So we, as the Fauna provider, the vendor, operate Fauna in multiple globally distributed regions, which are hosted on multiple cloud providers under the hood. You as a user don't have to care about that, because you just interact with an HTTPS API, which gives you this facade of ubiquitous, consistent access to the data wherever you happen to be querying from. And that leads to a lot of nice properties for you, because you can always guarantee that your writes will be consistently low latency regardless of where you are in the world, because there's no primary region or cluster that you have to talk to perform a write. You can guarantee the same thing for reads with even lower latency. Whichever Fauna region is nearest to your application, that's the region you'll be routed to do your work.
So if I understand this correctly, you have replication, you are a distributed system, and you even have regional distribution. But as a user, I don't really see that. I don't have to say, I want to use this version, and I don't have to think about where is my data and my some things go out of sync, because that's all covered, all cared for at your side.
Right. We're adding the ability to restrict the replication topology for compliance purposes, principally, because you know you don't always want all your data, given various legal regimes, replicated all around the world. But you know, Fauna's replication is semi-synchronous and always consistent from the perspective of any individual group of applications which are accessing the same data center. So it's impossible in the read-write transaction pipeline to violate consistency. And in the read-only transaction pipeline, it's impossible to violate it without deliberately going out of your way to pass information behind the scenes that you basically disallow Fauna from also seeing. So in practice, you get a consistent experience all the time, no matter who and how is interacting with your data set around the world.
Yeah, it is a distributed system, but as a user, you don't have to worry about it. You can just benefit from it.
Yeah, the model for you as a user is essentially the model of a single node RDBMS.
Yeah, like an old backend database.
Right, like you have a rack in the closet and it has the data and you access it and the data is always the data because it's only coming from one place. Like Fauna restores that illusion of the data coming from only one place to a completely globally distributed and highly available operational context.
At O'Reilly, we know your tech teams need quick answers to their most urgent questions. They need to stay on top of new tech developments. They need a safe place to learn the technologies your company adopts. And they need it all 24/7. Well, they can get it all at O'Reilly.com. With O'Reilly Online Learning, your team gets live online courses, tons of resources, safe interactive scenarios and sandboxes, and fast answers to their most pressing questions. Visit O'Reilly.com and request a demo.
So let's talk about real-time streaming, because that's something that Fauna also offers. So what is this? What is real-time streaming?
We have a feature in beta now, which basically takes the temporal model and upgrades it to an HTTP push, not just a pull. You could already pull on change sets, points in time, ranges in time. But in particular, for backing real-time applications, you want to get notified rather than query every 10 seconds or something like that. So Fauna lets you listen on individual documents for updates from both backend services or user applications, including browsers and mobile apps, that kind of thing. And then we're expanding this feature to also allow you to listen on entire collections and indexes as well.
So that means that I can implement something like an on new customer events, and then I can, I don't know, send an email to someone that a new customer has registered.
Yeah, or it's kind of topical right now. Like there's a lot of e-lines happening in the world right now. I've experienced some of them myself recently. Like if you want a new gaming console, you have to wait in an e-line. And you sign up and then you get notified when they're available and then you have to rush to try to grab the reservation. Or for the coronavirus vaccines, it's essentially the same process, even though it's federal and state agencies instead of like Sony who are offering you the website. All these kinds of experiences are really good examples for the power of something like Fauna, because both you need notification when something is available. You need the ability to order in a strictly serialized way who is in line so that you can be fair about allocating the opportunities. Then you need to make sure that only one person can buy a specific console and only one person can get a specific vaccine reservation. And that requires transactionality. In particular, it requires strict serializability. And if you're trying to do this in an eventually consistent system, you see a lot of the failure patterns that we're experiencing today, where it says, oh, consoles are available, but they're not. You go to checkout and it's gone. Vaccine appointments are available, but they're not. You go partly through the process, then you get booted out, and then you can't go back in because it wasn't reserved specifically for you. Someone has taken over your application, and it's a real mess.
That's what I really want to have, transactionality. It's very clear that this vaccine has been assigned, and there are so many left in stock.
Right. Yeah. It's like, I mean, I think, you know, people say that banking is like the canonical example for transactionality and the value of asset, but it's really not, because financial data can be reconciled after the fact. But I think the best example is this kind of process, basically like the Ticketmaster process, where people are competing to hear about an opportunity and reserve it in real time. And that just doesn't work in a distributed context without a database like Fauna.
That's a great business case where indeed it really makes sense to use a system like Fauna. What you also support, custom business logic as atomic functions. And we talked about this, I think, a little bit earlier, where you said something about stored procedures, because when I read custom business logic as atomic functions, then I did think, is that a stored procedure?
It is a stored procedure. Stored procedures aren't cool, but they're back in a big way. We call them functions analogous to serverless functions. And like I mentioned, Fauna is a programmable database. Like, what you're submitting to the database is not only reads and writes. You're submitting a mini program that executes in an atomic way over the state of the data at its point in the transaction log. That means, in particular, you can't do what you would do in SQL, which is have an interactive session transaction where your client chats back and forth with the database, accumulating the transaction over a period of requests. You have to submit the entire transaction to the database so that it can be strictly serialized as a block. That's not really a barrier to development. Most people don't really take advantage of interactive transactions in a meaningful way when they're building products with RDBMSs. Like, they use ORMs and other things like that that abstract away the session-based nature of the database anyway. So your experience developing against Fauna is similar, but it does mean that we have to offer a very rich standard library so that you can do a lot more of your compute work in the database co-located with the data in your transactions than you would typically be used to doing in an RDBMS or in a NoSQL system. But that also gives us the benefit that we can then bring back stored procedures as functions and let you basically save particular parameterized transactions as your own standard library that you can then call and compose in your other queries to the database. And that lets you do a lot of your business modeling in the database, which has the advantage of also being secure. So you can access it directly from insecure clients like mobile apps and browsers and that kind of thing. It lets you manage that code in a clear and consistent way. This is another example where the temporality comes into play. Because the database is temporal, so are the functions. So you get, you know, version control over your code in the database itself and that kind of thing. And it gives you back a lot of the power that was lost when we moved from kind of the client server architecture in the early 90s to three-tier architecture with the web, where the application had to orchestrate everything and it basically used the database as the dumbest possible transactional key value store, because you couldn't scale the compute layer of the database in particular. And also, you know, there were a host of security and code management issues involved in using stored procedures from web applications. But that doesn't mean the model is broken. It just means that, you know, the implementation and the patterns people were trying to achieve in their applications had diverged.
So I really want to hear more about this programmable database. What is programmable? Like, firstly, what programming language do you write? Do you write your SQL language? Is this what you write the stored procedures in? Or do you have language bindings for JavaScript?
You do write it in FQL. In the future, we want to expand that. But right now, we're focused on making the FQL standard library as comprehensive as possible. And FQL is fundamentally a Lisp. It's a functional language, which is composable and type safe. It's Turing complete because you can recurse. We don't recommend mining Bitcoin and Fauna, but you know, eventually someone's going to do it. The benefit of this model, and it goes back to some of the Lindo work, or you probably know it as like Java spaces and that kind of stuff, is that you can execute computations co-located with your data. And that makes them much more efficient and also much more consistent than when you have to query back and forth from application code and run compute incrementally in the app while you then do reads and writes also incrementally and interleaved in the database. And that lets us then give you essentially this ubiquitous data API, this data fabric, in which you can compose not just your schemas and your data models, but also a lot of the business logic around those data models too. And then you can focus on the presentation logic and application code and keep those tiers well segmented and also maintain both performance, high availability, and consistency for all the business logic, which is implemented in the database itself.
So that also means that these stored procedures are ran on your side. So they're not ran client side, but ran on your side. And also they're always run on the same machine where the data also lives. Is that what I'm doing?
They are. They're run in the database kernel. We don't like shell out to Lambda or something like that. Fauna's multi-tenancy model is really unique. Fauna is all dynamically scheduled. When you sign up for Fauna, you instantaneously get a new database that you can access immediately. The reason we can do that is that we never provision a static resource for anybody. All the isolation is dynamic. It's essentially equivalent to cooperative multi-threading, which you may remember from Windows 95. The interpreter of the query ASTs is inserting yield points like Windows 95 at IOs and loop boundaries, which then fault back to the scheduler. And that happens on a millisecond basis so that we can interleave long-running queries, we can track quotas, we can prioritize and deprioritize usage across tenants, within tenants, all that kind of thing. And we can do that within the stored procedures, the functions too. So we can maintain performance and security isolation without having to statically allocate anything. And that lets us not have to worry about running complex computations co-located with the data, which then lets them obviously have zero latency to data on the local node, low latency to data that's partitioned on adjacent nodes and that kind of thing.
So let's dive into writing queries in more depth even, because what you say is that you have a multi-model interface. So you support document storage, relational data, graph data, and also temporal data sets. And this is actually something that we covered earlier in the show in episode 353. So can you tell us a little bit more about how those different models work and especially how they also collaborate? When do you use one? When do you use the other? Can you mix and match within a query? How does that work?
I think we as a team have a unique view on this problem. So to us, there are two fundamental data models. There's the document model like Mongo to normalize everything into a rich, flexible document. And your transaction boundaries basically are the document boundaries. You can consistently update the document itself. Outside of that context, all bets are off. Then there's the relational model. Set up a schema ahead of time, build indexes, enforce foreign keys, achieve fifth normal form if you're super into that, all that kind of stuff. Like it's the opposite of denormalization. It's aggressively normalized. It's literally in the name. And use that to both reduce redundancy, which improves consistency because you're not duplicating the same data and where you might mess it up. And also, it works well with storage layouts and so on of the traditional RDBMS. That's all you need in terms of fundamental data models to build almost any application. And thus, Fauna is a document relational database where it offers those relational links, indexes, views, foreign keys, transactions between flexible documents that don't have rigid schema, although they are typed, that allow you to dynamically populate data without having to go through migrations and so on. And the other models you mentioned, temporality and graph, they're not standalone models. There are additional capabilities that can be added to the core document relational model. You don't have to get a graph database to do graph queries, as many people who use join tables very successfully in RDBMSs to model graphs understand. You know, you don't have to go get some off-the-shelf proprietary temporal database to have temporality. Sometimes people do dump change data into, in particular, logging systems like Splunk, and that becomes kind of an ad hoc temporal database. But to me, that's a defect in the core system they're using, not a paradigm in its own right. So what we've done in Fauna is, with FQL, unify the document relational model in a very coherent way, and then augment it with temporality and graph querying, in particular, the kind of pointer traversal that you would do in a graph data model where you don't have to have enforced foreign keys and can just link documents willy-nilly to each other. That interacts very well with the rest of Fauna's standard library, so that in the same application, in the same query, on the same data set, you can take advantage of the benefits of these models without having to think like, am I in graph land now? Am I in relational land now? Is my data even in the right data system to run the query I want to run? And I think our GraphQL interface, and GraphQL, despite the name, is not really a graph API, it's a document API, expresses the power of the core Fauna semantics in that it offers a view into the same data with a different syntax, so that you can keep the semantics and the data fully shared and access it how you please from the application side.
So before we dive into writing queries in these different models, I want to talk a little bit more about what it means that you have unified the document model and the relational model, because to me, those things sound irreconcilable. How did you unify this? What does that even mean?
Every document has an implied schema. You have a local graph structure. You have keys which are nested that have values. They may have multi-value attributes like arrays. They, you know, could have objects which themselves nest even further, and so on and so on. So what we do is, rather than enforcing the schema upfront on data ingest, we rely on the presence of this implied schema to introspect the documents and understand what the relations are supposed to be. So like when you compose an index in Fauna is actually more like a relational view. It's an explicit materialization of data from documents. It can even compose data from multiple collections of documents. It can transform it. It can do very view-like things to express a different dimensionality, a different transformation, a different composition of the data in your data set. You know, that doesn't say what is the schema, you know, for this collection. It says, well, I'm going to assume that the keys, the values, the paths expressed in the view may exist in the documents, and as we traverse them, you know, if they're there, I'll include them, and if they're not, that document will be elided from the output of the view. It gives you the ability to, you know, basically take the core relational properties, joins, foreign keys, transactions, normalization, and apply them to what may not be a fully normalized data model. It could be a completely denormalized document. But the relational model fundamentally can be fit into the document record paradigm, and documents can be fit into the relational querying paradigm. Those things aren't intrinsically opposed.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's really interesting. So how does that reflect into queries then? Do you have a relational accent of FQL and a document-based version of the query language, or can this be mixed within one query?
No, it's all one language with shared semantics. You know, where there are differences is in the alternate interfaces to the database. So FQL is kind of the central point, the point that expresses all possible semantics that Fauna supports. You interact with FQL with the application drivers that give you an ORM-like experience. They give you a DSL. You're not writing FQL syntax. But you can also interact with the database with GraphQL syntax. You can use GraphQL clients to access your data through the semantics of Fauna that GraphQL also overlaps with, are what we support and what we want to maintain. Like, we're not trying to be a standards compliant, comprehensive GraphQL client and let you do, for example, service composition, which is one of the big value props of GraphQL, letting you compose different data sources into a single query. Well, we're just one data source, and we're not the right place for you to be calling out to other services you may own. But if that's the interface you're familiar with, then you can access Fauna in this way. And we intend to add other syntaxes in the future.
Are those the only two languages that you support, or are there multiple that you support at this point?
So those are the only two right now, but we intend to add other languages to the extent that they fit the Fauna semantic model. You know, we'll implement that part of the spec, but we won't try to be comprehensive. We won't try to be drop-in compatible with existing other systems, that kind of thing.
You just briefly mentioned indexing, and I read that you do indexing on the fly. What does that mean?
Fauna indexes are similar to relational indexes in that they're kept transactionally up to date. You can add an index at any time. It asynchronously builds in the background. Once it's ready, it's available for querying. You express your queries by explicitly referring to the index, which is a current difference from the relational model in terms of performance management. Like, you know, a lot of people are familiar with hinting in SQL, where you build an index and you want to make sure it's always used. Fauna is effectively an always hinted system, which helps us maintain predictable performance for your queries at scale. Those indexes, once they're asynchronously built, are themselves serializable. So when you update your documents, the indexes are updated in synchronous real time such that you don't have any divergence when you query them from an application side.
Something else that I want to dive into. So you could say that you're not entirely responsible, right, for how people use your system. But what I was thinking about when you were describing that you both support the relational model and also the document model, the schema-less model, how do you force developers to work properly? Maybe I'm a bad developer, but I think I would worry that what would happen to me is I think, oh, I don't need a schema. I put a bit of data here and I put a bit of data there. A benefit of the traditional relational model is also that you are forced to think of what is the data type of this column and what is the name of this column and how does this collection go together, which sometimes slows you down, but also forces you to work in a systematic way and to think in a systematic way. Like sometimes you get a database error because it says, oh, but this column is of the data type integer. And then you're like, oh, yeah, that's true. I put that constraint there for a reason. Do you know how people that use Fauna, how do they balance this freedom?
Our goal is to maximize flexibility and let you basically opt in over time to additional constraints as your application matures. So when you're starting out, you should totally just put some data here and there and mess around and see how it goes and try to get it working. I think it's unrealistic to envision sitting down, you know, with a blank editor window and saying, I know what all my data models are going to be, let me write them out. Like, you can do that once the application is mature, but especially now, applications are never mature. They're always changing. So you always need the ability to both enforce and maintain the invariants which you've decided are, for the time being, truly invariant, and still have the flexibility to augment and experiment with new aspects of the application or the product you're building. So right now, the best way to kind of enforce those invariants is through indexes, which let you, like I said, you know, transform existing documents, skip over ones that don't match, expose a view which is very consistent in schema and output and even the values of the records themselves, because you can do almost anything within an index. You can call stored procedures and so on. So you can really remix your data in unique and application-specific ways. And if you always query through those indexes, you'll only see the consistent view of the data. Also, the functions, the stored procedures, can do things like check types and do casting and that kind of thing and error out if something doesn't match. So you can use those to lock down your writes and reads to patterns which themselves will enforce, you know, proper data ingest and proper data egress. We do intend to add optional typing in the future, which will let you basically do what the stored procedures do in a declarative way instead of a procedural way and say, you know, I do have a column that I know what its type is, I know what its default is, I want to enforce that, fail or populate a specific value for writes that don't match and so on. And that will also let us get closer to the ability to take a relational schema, a relational database, and directly import it into Fauna with no ETL, no transformation from that columnar model.
Yeah, I was just going to say, when you were describing your design philosophy, that it reminded me a bit of gradual typing in Dart, where indeed you can start entirely freeform, and then as your application matures, you add more structure. And it seems that this is something that really fits with what you're saying as well. The functions, the stored procedures, help you to retrofit the structure into the unstructured data that you might have started off with, right?
They do, but you know, they're procedural. They're not type declarations. So Fauna is dynamically typed, but it is typed. Like, it's not tickle, right? You're not just, you know, assuming a type when you go to execute a function. You're actually doing type checks. And we can expose those types to the developers so they can declare them and enforce them and add code to, you know, make decisions when the type doesn't match and so on. And merge the document model with the dynamic typing better with the relational columnar model with static typing, and let you mix and match even in the same collection, which is equivalent to a table, even in the same collection or document, some enforced types, some implied or derived types, and some aspects of the document which aren't typed at all.
So I want to circle back to something I said all the way in the beginning of the episode, because when I was saying like what I read about Fauna on your website, something that you also said was developer friendly that we haven't talked about, but I think we talked about it in a sense, because I heard many things that I think are very developer friendly, like the flexibility and the possibility to switch between these different forms of databasing. But I do want to ask you as well, like, why do you say Fauna is developer friendly? Can you give an example of a feature that you specifically say, well, this is what we put in to make the lives of developers, to make the lives of our users easier?
A good example of that is the authentication and identity system. If you're coming from an RDBMS or even something like Mongo or Cassandra, you're used to administrative security control only. Can somebody add and drop tables, which tables they can query, and so on? We took a look at that, and so we said, you know, this isn't how people are building applications. They're not building them for table-by-table access. They don't care which SQL statements the user can run. They care what data they can access. And also, they want users to be able to access data securely from anywhere, not just from a trusted application tier and so on. We borrowed an authentication model native to the web and support row-level, token-based, what we call attribute-based access control, which lets you very granularly declare what parts of a record, which records and which collections and which scopes can be accessible to specific identities, both at the user level and the administrative level. And that's also integrated with third-party authentication providers like Auth0, which, you know, let you then bring the database sort of into the web service topology you're already using and not have it be its own island where the application has to interpret web security policies and apply them, usually without relying on the database security model at all, and force them in application code because there's such an impedance mismatch there. So like Fauna is a very complex system, and it may sound scary from this conversation to interact with it, but all that complexity is there to prevent you from ever having to think about it. So that from your perspective, you're writing clear queries in your native application language in a DSL that makes sense, that has access to the entire ecosystem of integrated services you would expect to be there. And you just don't have to care what happens beyond that query boundary, but you can rely on enforcement of the security policies pervasive through the data tier. You don't have to worry if somebody writing a mobile app implemented the same security checks that the web app implements and all that kind of usual stuff. You don't have to worry about SQL injection because the system is type safe and doesn't rely on string interpolation and that kind of thing. So we're really trying to basically push the hurdles to building a secure, scalable, performant application down to the point that you don't think about them anymore.
Yeah, so really your interpretation of developer friendly is that you do all the work, all the hard work is on the side of Fauna, and for the user, it seems like a simple database system that like we would be used to before there was distributed systems, but you do enable the user to use, to benefit from the power of a distributed system.
Right. We want to give you the upside and not the downside. And I mean, a lot of the downside is operational and administrative. In particular, we've done a lot of work to eliminate that completely. Fauna is a a zero operation system. And that's not to say that we don't endeavor to offer operational transparency. Like, you need to know what's happening in your data, but you shouldn't have to be responsible for doing things in the database just to keep it running.
Yeah, I think that concludes everything I wanted to ask you today. Is there anything that we missed? Anything you would like to share about Fauna that I haven't asked you?
I would just encourage you. We have drivers for almost all popular application languages. You know, try it out. You can sign up for free. You don't need a credit card. Your database is instantly available. Try it out and let us know what you think.
And where would we try it out? What is the link that we can put in the show notes?
Fauna.com. F-A-U-N-A.
We'll definitely put that in the show notes. Is there any other place that we can follow you? Are you on Twitter? Do you have a blog that we can read?
I am on Twitter. My Twitter handle is Evan, just E-V-A-N.
Oh, that's easy. That's a benefit of being an early employee.
Yeah, it is. I'm also Evan on GitHub, though. So
we'll put that in the show notes as well. So thank you very much for being on the show with us today.
Thanks so much for having me.
Keeping your teams on top of the latest tech developments is a monumental challenge. Helping them get answers to urgent problems they face daily is even harder. That's why 66% of all Fortune 100 companies count on O'Reilly Online Learning. At O'Reilly, your teams will get live courses, tons of resources, interactive scenarios and sandboxes, and fast answers to their pressing questions. See what O'Reilly Online Learning can do for your teams. Visit O'Reilly.com for a demo.
Thanks for listening to SE Radio, an educational program brought to you by IEEE Software Magazine. For more about the podcast, including other episodes, visit our website at se-radio.net. To provide feedback, you can comment on each episode on the website or reach us on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, or through our Slack channel at seradio.slack.com. You can also email us at team@se-radio.net. This and all other episodes of SE Radio is licensed under Creative Commons License 2.5. Thanks for listening.